And verse 22, Matthew 14:22. And straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him unto the other side, while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. I have underlined in my Bible the two words, was contrary. The wind was contrary. I see this metaphorically as just the affairs of life. Things that I face in life sometimes are contrary. Contrary to what I see in the Word of God as being the will of God for me. What is the will of God? The Word of God. And sometimes situations, circumstances, life, the things that occur are contrary to the Word of God. Well, the waves, the wind, the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves. The wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It is a spirit." And they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, "Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid." You know, the Lord always has a positive note. I believe if we're listening to him and following him, we'll have a positive note. I don't think that we ought to look at the storm and speak the fear. Jesus, on more than one occasion, I remember in Mark chapter 4 when they were, he had said, "Let's pass over and go to the other side." There was a storm that day. He's asleep with his head on a pillow. And they were in fear because the waves were coming into the ship full. I mean, they're still floating. And he's asleep, so it's not, he's not underwater. So when it means full, it means dangerous. Not up to the rail necessarily, because he's not underwater. But the waves are coming into the ship, and they see this as a serious problem. And they wake him up. Well, he rebuked the wind, the wave, the sea, and there was a great calm. And then actually he rebuked them, because he asked them, "Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith in this situation?" He didn't mean in general, just all of the time, but right now. Well, he's the one that was not fearful. They were. He's the one operating in faith. They weren't. And it would be wrong for him to rebuke them unless he believed they could have been operating in faith too. It would be wrong for them, for him, to rebuke them unless he believed they could have avoided the fear. And sometimes I'm aware of myself. I'm also aware of other people. Sometimes I've been around some people. Sometimes it seemed like me and Susan, the only one there operating in faith. Everybody's in fear. I've been around some ministers. I go to a minister's meeting. You know, I'm not me and Susan, me by myself. Go to a minister's meeting and they're talking about the battle. You know, how goes the battle? They're asking for prayer requests. I went to one as a first time visitor. They had me come. They wanted to get to know me, and I preached in their convention. But it's a group of ministers. And I'm new, so I didn't speak much, but they're wanting me to speak. So they're asking for a prayer request. Well, I deferred and went around the room till it came back to me very last. But everybody I noticed that when they had a prayer request, "Well, we're going to go to prayer in a moment. We want to have prayer request." Every prayer request. I mean, every prayer, not most of them, all of them was on all of the misery of their ministry. I mean, I felt like a fish out of water. I did not feel like I belonged in this group of unbelieving preachers. Felt like I was the only one in the place that had any faith and no fear. They're talking about how horrible everything is, how bad everything is, and they want prayer because they want God to help them in the midst of their storm and the battle. And they came around to me, and I didn't really have much of a prayer request. I mean, I don't know how they're going to pray with this atmosphere of unbelief anyway, you sort of, sometimes you feel like you're the only one in the room or in the place that is walking in faith instead of fear, and people are making decisions based on circumstances and the fear of the circumstances. Well, the circumstances existed in Mark 4. And Jesus got up and he just rebuked it, and there was a great calm. He said, peace. He rebuked the wind, the wave, peace, be still. And there was a great calm. Then he rebuked them because they could have done that. They didn't have to have fear when he had said, we're going to pass over and go to the other side. It doesn't matter what the storm is doing. We're going to pass over and go to the other side. Jesus said so. If Jesus said so, that's what we're going to do. Now, it doesn't happen just because he said it. You need to believe it and act on it. In Hebrews, it says the word, chapter 4, verse 2, it said the word preached didn't profit. Well, it's the word of God. The word of God is going to come forth. In a general sense, God will bring his word to pass. But in a specific individual sense, it's up to me. It's up to you. Because in Hebrews 4, 2, it says the word preached didn't profit them. Well, why didn't it profit them? It's the word of God. Well, it wasn't mixed with faith. The word of God goes into the earth to accomplish, and God says it's going to accomplish where it's sent. But he has long patience waiting for the fruit of the whole earth. He's waiting for the fruit of the whole earth, has long patience waiting for it. What's he waiting for? Well, Jesus said, when the Son of Man returns, will he find faith on the earth? He's waiting for the word of God to be mixed with faith. The word is to be preached, and God's waiting for that to happen. And then the word preached is to be fruitful, and God's waiting on that to happen. It has to be mixed with faith. Well, Jesus said, let's pass over and go to the other side, Mark chapter 4. He wanted them to believe that. Instead, when the storm came to talk them out of the faith, it succeeded in talking them out of their faith. How do I know the storm succeeded in talking them out of their faith? Jesus said so. Jesus said, right now, you guys have no faith. Well, why do they have no faith? The storm robbed them. The storm talked them out of it. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word. They heard Jesus say, let's pass over and go the other side. They heard that. Let us pass and go over to the other side. Let's pass and go over. Let's pass. He didn't say, let's go to the middle and sink. He said, we're going to the other side. He didn't say, we're going to go as far as the storm will let us. He didn't say, well, we're going to go as long as the Lord gives us the strength. When the storm occurred, he didn't say, well, I guess this is God's way of showing us it's not his will to pass over and go to the other side. He didn't believe the storm was God's will. He didn't believe everything that happened was God's will. Well, God's going to do his will. The storm was not God's will, and Jesus knew it. Well, I just believe everything happens for a reason. I just believe God has a purpose in everything that happened. That's what people say. I just believe God has a purpose in everything that happens. Well, the purpose here is for Jesus to rebuke it, because it's not from God at all. God is not working against himself. Did God do it? Well, somebody says, well, God allowed it for a reason. Well, the only reason I can see is the devil's against the progress of God. Jesus is saying, let's go and pass over to the other side. The devil's against that. He wants to stop that. The storm came. They were afraid. It did rob them of faith, but it didn't rob Jesus of faith. And Jesus woke up and just rebuked it. I'm sometimes around people. I want to say to them, where's your faith? Oh, ye of little faith. Jesus said that. In fact, here in Matthew 14, we'll see it in a moment. He asked Peter about it. But in Mark 4, he said, how is it you have no faith? Why are you so fearful? Well, the circumstances. Brother Tony, don't you see what's happening? Why are you so fearful? People say, I'm just afraid it's going to get worse. Well, it will. The lion and the bear, somebody could have told David, you know it's going to get worse? It did. But when Goliath came, he ran toward him. I'd rather be in that camp of the people that are running toward him and saying, this day I'll take your head off. I'm going to feed your carcass to the fowls of the air. That's what I'm going to be. Who are you? Who does he think he is? Who are you? Well, he's the champion of the Philistines. The Philistines. Who is he to defy the God of Israel? I'm going to take his head off is what I'm going to do. And that's little David, just a young lad. And he wouldn't even put on the king's armor. He said, I've not proven it, but I know what I have proven. You see, there was a trial, there was a test, there was an experience, and he learned something through the experience. Well, he wasn't afraid of the lion. He wasn't afraid of the bear, but he proved what that sling would do. And now he's not afraid of Goliath. I think some people, I wonder what experiences they've had. We're to walk by faith. That doesn't mean I have confidence I'm going to go to heaven when I die. The just shall live by faith. I hear Christians quoting these verses like they don't know what they mean. Well, without faith, it's impossible to please him. We're to walk by faith. The just shall live by faith. What does that mean? That means whatever his word says, that overcomes whatever the circumstances say. And it doesn't matter what the circumstances say. If I have the word of God that is in response to that matter, then I'm to walk in the light of the word of God. I see healing there. And sickness comes. Well, if I'm going to walk by faith, I'm going to walk in healing, not sickness. I see that he supplies all my need. Well, they say that there's a Wall Street crash. Well, he supplies my need. I'm going to walk by faith. They say, well, times are bad and this is coming. Well, he causes me to overcome and triumph and I have the victory. That's how I'm going to walk. That's how I'm going to live. That's how I'm going to talk. And I'm to live by faith. I'm to walk by faith. It's impossible to please him any other way. Well, I just believe I'm going to go to heaven when I die and I've got to keep that faith. That's true. All right. That's a part of it. But the real faith is according to the word of God, and the word of God involves more than you just going to heaven when you die. How am I going to live here right now in the sweet by and by? One day I'm going to die. What about here and now? I want to learn how to live here and now. That just is where I focus. I'm glad I'm going to heaven, and I want to know some things about heaven, and I want to help people get ready for heaven. But what burns in my heart is to help people learn how to live here right now. And what does the word say about my circumstances? And I'm to walk according to that. I'm to live according to that. And it's impossible to please him any other way. That's what these verses mean. And so Jesus asked them, how is it you have no faith? The faith of my word, when I said we're going to pass over and go to the other side, should have kept you without any fear. Whatever this storm says, sometimes I won't ask people that. Why are you in fear? Well, I better not do that. Why? Because, and then they'll mention the circumstances. Well, I've got some scripture I can mention. Well, I know that's in there, Brother Tony, but don't put that in there. Just quote the word of God and leave it right there. Where the word of God says this, and I believe it, and I'm going to do it, and I'm going to walk in the light of it, and I'm expecting it to happen, and I'm full of joy and cheer and expectancy, and I'm just going to have a big time. Amen. Well, Jesus, here in Matthew 14, coming back there, he said, be not afraid. He's always got a note of good cheer. They're in a storm. And they think this is a ghost, a spirit. So he said, it's I. Don't be afraid. I believe Christians today ought to have a good note. They ought to have a note of victory. Well, I just believe it's getting bad. Well, let's don't dwell on that. Well, I'm just afraid it's going to get worse. Well, it is going to get worse, and you shouldn't be afraid. We should be full of faith and not fear, and we should be quoting the word of God instead of circumstances and the storms of life. I believe we ought to have a note of victory in every situation of life that we face, a note of victory. Well, be not afraid, it's I. Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid. Peter answered him, said, Lord, if it's you, bid me come unto thee on the water. I heard a minister, more than one minister, say that Peter has sort of boxed him in a corner, roped him in, gotten him manipulated to say something he really didn't want to say. Jesus really wanted to say, no, you're not ready, don't come. Because more than one minister, I've heard them say, Peter was not ready to walk on the water. Peter was not ready. But what could I say? He said, if it's you bid me come, what was I supposed to say? It's not me. I had to tell him it was me. And he wasn't ready. He got down off the boat and into the water before he was ready. But I couldn't do anything about it. I was just roped into a corner. I was just boxed in. I was painted in a corner and I couldn't get out. I had to tell him, come, because it is me. Hogwash. I don't know how you think you're going to box God in. Put God in a box and he has to do it. Jesus could have said, do you believe you can? He could have answered a question with a question. Lord, if it's you, bid me come. Do you believe you can? He'd ask a question on occasion. Two blind men following him, crying, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on us. And Jesus said, do you believe that I'm able to do this? Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on us. What is it that you desire to receive our sight? Do you believe that I'm able to do this? Matthew 9, he asked them, do you believe that I'm able to do this? Blind Bartimaeus in Mark chapter 10, he asked him, what have you desired? He's asking questions. He's not boxed into a corner. He's not roped in. He's not painted in a corner and boxed in and roped in and can't get out. He said, do you believe that I'm able to do this? What is it that you want? Jesus, if it's you, bid me come. Do you believe you can? No, Jesus knew he was ready. Jesus knew he had faith. I've heard more than one preacher. They don't understand what's going on here. I've heard more than one preacher say, Peter didn't have enough faith. If he had had more faith, he would have walked on the water. Well, do you have as much faith as he did have? He walked a little bit. Let's see what you can do. He walked a little bit, and it doesn't have anything to do with how much faith he had. It has everything to do with how much word he's believing. And is he continuing to believe? He started out believing the word of Jesus. Come, he believed that, and he started out good. The will of God is that Peter walk on the water. The miracle has begun. You know, it's miraculous to walk on the water. And the miracle has begun. I think sometimes people receive the beginning of a miracle, but it doesn't finish. And they go their way saying, well, I guess this is God's will. He didn't want me to have it after all. The miracle can begin and not be completed. And Peter is the reason why. When it was all over and Jesus is talking to him, Jesus did not say to Peter, well, I guess it wasn't God's will. You know, we just missed it. I said for you to come. Well, you said, if it's you, bid me come. And I said, come. I mean, I'm answering, yes, it's me, come. But I guess I just missed it. You weren't ready. It wasn't God's will. Jesus didn't say any of that. When it was all over, see, Peter beginning to sink, cried, Lord, save me. Jesus did. And when they got back to the boat, Jesus did not say to Peter, no, he did not say to Peter, I guess it wasn't God's will. Because after all, if it had been God's will, you would have walked on the water. Because after all, if he calls you to it, he'll bring you through it. I mean, after all, nothing's up to you. After all, it's all up to God. God's in control. Just give it into the Lord's hand. Give it all to the Lord. Put it in his hand. That kind of teaching bothers me because it takes the responsibility away from the person. And the devil loves this kind of deception. He wants you defeated. Yes, he does. And if he can rob you of your responsibility and your accountability and your position in receiving from God, he'll rob you. Well, just give it all to God. No, the word of faith has to be preached and then it has to be believed. It has to be mixed with faith. The word preached has to be mixed with faith. Well, Jesus told Peter, come, and he came and walked on the water. What happened? What was the change? What was the difference? Why did he begin to sink? He saw the wind boisterous. What's that got to do with anything? People today are looking at the wind. People today are looking at the storm. People today are looking at circumstances, and they're not acknowledging the Lord, and therefore he's not directing their paths. They're acknowledging the storm. They're acknowledging their natural ability in the midst of the storm. They're acknowledging what they should be able to do in the storm. Well, if you're going to look at your natural ability, you're going to sink. If you're going to look at common sense, I mean, thank God for common sense. I think some Christians ought to have more of it. But when you're mixing the natural and the supernatural will override it. And we ought to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. When your mind is renewed with the Word of God, you think different, you talk different, you act different, you respond to circumstances differently because you're transformed. You've got to think different. You've got to have the renewing of your mind to the place where you're transformed and you react differently to the things, the situations, the adversities, the tragedies, the consequences are different because the storms of life do not affect you. The storm can come. I think about those two people that Jesus spoke of. They came, heard, but one did and one did not do. The storm came. The storm came. But the one that heard his sayings and did them, the storm could not shake him. But the one that heard his sayings and didn't do them, that house fell, and immediately it fell and there was great destruction. The only difference is doing the word. They both came to Jesus. They both heard his sayings. One did the sayings of Jesus. One didn't. The storm came to both houses. One house stood, could not be shaken. The other house fell, and it had great destruction. The only difference is doing the word. They both came. They both heard. Well, I just believe God's word's going to put me over when you believe it and do it. And then the storm has to it doesn't shake you. The storm has no power. The storm has no power over the supernatural side of the child of God. We ought to walk in the supernatural. Well, in the natural, you sink. He saw the wind boisterous. So he got into the natural, his own natural ability. Well, Brother Tony, you just need to have some common sense. I believe in common sense, but I'm not afraid of that because I also have some supernatural sense. The faith, the victory that overcomes the world. See, in the world, I'll have tribulation, but Jesus said, be of good cheer, I've overcome. And the victory that overcomes is faith, and the faith comes from the Word of God. And when the Word of God is giving me the answer to this situation, then the storm has no power. I see the storm all right, but it's not going to affect me. And don't talk me out of my faith. Don't talk me into your unbelief. I'll watch you. I'll see you. Jesus cared about Peter. Now, beginning to sink, he didn't go down like a shot. You don't begin to sink. If you were to step out off of the pier into a lake, you don't begin to sink. You just go down like a shot. You just go down. And so he beginning to sink. I don't know that he even got knee deep. I mean, he's aware that his faith is slipping. He's aware that the foundation is slipping. I don't believe he even got knee deep. I mean, maybe he did. Maybe he's above his knees, but he's going down slowly. Faith is that way today. Faith is that way yet. That you can sense, if you will be sensitive, you can sense your faith slipping. And you can catch it. I see that I'm slipping and I'm not going to slip. Peter could have said when he realized that he's beginning to sink because he saw the storm, when he realized he's beginning to sink because he saw the storm, when he realized he's beginning to sink, he could have gotten his eyes back on Jesus and off of the storm and said to Jesus, you told me to come, I'm coming. I know I've gotten my eyes off you and on the storm, and I began to sink. There for a little while, I was sinking. I didn't go down completely, but I could tell I'm slipping. And I'm not going to slip. I'm getting my eyes off the storm, back on you. And you said, come, and I'm coming. And he would have stepped back on the water. He would have rise back up. Because the supernatural is what holding him up anyway. The supernatural would have raised him back up. He's walking in the supernatural. And if the supernatural can hold him up, the supernatural can raise him back up. If he had ever got to the place where he's going to walk in the supernatural, he would have no longer began to sink. He would have began to rise. He would have come right back up onto the water. He could have done that. And I'm glad it's in here. I'm glad Matthew 14 is in here because it teaches me I can do that. He could have, he didn't, but I can When I catch myself and I'm beginning to sink, I can get my eyes off of the storm and stop reacting to it and stop responding to it and stop doing according to what the natural says is the way I'm supposed to act. I've been transformed by the renewing of my mind. I'm supernatural. I'm going to get my eyes back on the Word of God. Father, here's your word. This is what you said. This is what I believe. This is what I'm going to do. This is what I am doing. And I'll tell you what, I'll just rise back up and walk on the water. The same water that was holding him up when he's walking in faith is the same water that'll drown him when he goes down. Paul said, writing to the Corinthians, he said, the light affliction works for us. Our light affliction, which is but for a moment, works for us. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Around verse 16, verse 17. Our light affliction, which is but for a moment, temporary, works for us. That water was holding him up. That water was working for him. That water was holding him up. He's walking on the water. Somebody said he's walking on faith. Well, it's the faith of Jesus' word, but he's walking on the water. It says he's walking on the water. Jesus was walking on the sea. So the sea is holding Jesus up. He's walking on it. The water is holding Peter up. He's walking on it. And this says in 2 Corinthians 4, verse 17, our light affliction works for us. That water was working for Peter. Well, how did it work? It worked for him when he didn't look at it. When he looked at Jesus and the Word of God, the Word of Jesus, Jesus said, come, that's the Word of God to Peter, come. When Peter was looking at the Word, that water was working for him. Well, water will drown you. And not only is it water, it's a storm. And that water will drown you. Well, it won't drown me, it'll work for me. People say, Brother Tony, don't you know that'll kill you? No, it won't kill me. If I'm mixing faith with it, in the natural it may have this effect, but it won't have that effect on me. Well, don't you see the circumstances? Sure, I see them, but I'm walking on them. I'm above only, I'm not beneath. How are you today, Brother Tony? How are you under the circumstances? I'm not under them. Well, everything's okay under the circumstances. Don't get under them. We're to be above only, not beneath. We're the head, not the tail. I'm to walk. Well, this light affliction works for us. But if you notice the next verse, it's why we don't look at it. If you look at it, it won't work for you anymore. If you look at the circumstances won't work for you anymore. They'll work against you. And when Peter started looking at the circumstances, that water stopped working for him. It started working against him. It started working against him. It started working against him instead of working for him. It didn't hold him up. It was bringing him in. It no longer held him up. It was bringing him in. It's all where he's looking. Instead of looking at Jesus, he's looking at the storm. While he's not looking at the storm, it's working for him. While he is looking at the storm, it's working against him. Did he have enough faith? Faith's not the issue here. Faith is not the problem. The doubt is. Faith created the miracle. It would have completed it if he had stayed in faith. Faith created the miracle. Faith would complete it. See, the miracle began, but it wasn't completed. I think many people today, they receive healing and then they go their way and 3 days later, they're back sick again. It didn't complete. Well, I just believe if God does anything, he'll finish it. Well, Peter began to sink and it wasn't because Jesus didn't want to finish it. Well, it wasn't God's will. When Jesus spoke to Peter later, after it's over, and let me talk to you now and help you. He didn't say, well, I better not say anything to Peter. This might hurt his feelings. You know, I don't want to offend him. I don't want to hurt his feelings. After all, he tried. What I'm going to do is just pat him on the back and give him a attaboy. You did good. No, he wants him to learn. The reason that you began to sink isn't God's will. He didn't say, well, God didn't want you to walk. He didn't say you didn't have enough faith. He didn't say, it wasn't God's will. It wasn't my will. It wasn't your faith. Faith is not the issue. He had enough faith because he's walking on the water. Why didn't he complete? Doubt. That's what Jesus said. That's what he mentioned. Doubt and fear. Doubt. Everybody say doubt. Everybody say fear. Those are the two things that robbed Peter of the completion of the miracle. Why did you doubt? Why are you fearful? Or how is it that you have no faith? Same thing here. So you have little faith. In Mark 4, it's you have no faith. In Mark 4, it's why are you so fearful? You notice fear and faith are opposites there. In Mark 4, how is it you have no faith? Why are you so fearful? Mark 4, it's faith and fear. In Matthew 14, it's doubt and faith, faith and doubt. Faith and doubt, faith and fear. Fear and doubt are the enemies to faith. In Mark 4, why are you so fearful? How is it you have no faith? In Matthew 14, why did you doubt? Oh, ye of little faith. In Matthew 14, it's doubt in faith. In Mark 4, it's fear in faith. Both places faith is mentioned. One place doubt is, another place fear is. Fear and doubt are the enemies to faith. James said, ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea driven of the wind and tossed. Let not that man think he'll receive anything of the Lord. Wavering is the same thing. When you're looking at the circumstances and you're changing how you think, you're changing how you react, you're changing how you respond, that's when you have to catch it. The circumstances should not change your believing, your saying, your doing. The circumstances should not change how you live and how you act. Oh, David saw Goliath. Well, there is a change. What change? He ran toward him. That's the change. He saw Goliath. What change? This day I'm going to take your head off. That's what he started saying. I'm going to walk on the water, then get busy about it. Come, you hear God, you hear the word of God, you know it's the word of God to you, then act on it. And then when the circumstances rise up, don't change. Keep doing what you were doing. Keep believing what you were believing. Keep saying what you were saying. That's what patience is. James said, let patience have her perfect work. You'll be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. Patience, when it's put to work, maintains what you're saying, what you're doing, what you're believing, regardless of the circumstances. Patience says, in the midst of the circumstances, I'm going to keep believing what I was believing. I'm going to keep saying what I was saying. I'm going to keep doing what I was doing. And I'm going to put patience to work. I don't see it yet. I don't have the manifestation yet. I don't have the full corn in the ear. I don't have the harvest yet, but I'm going to keep watering it and weeding it and tending to it. I'm going to keep tending to my garden. I'm going to keep at it. I'm going to let patience have her perfect work. I'll be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. I'm going to keep believing it. I'm going to keep saying it. I'm going to keep doing it. The circumstances aren't going to change me. Well, Peter, why did you doubt? Oh, ye of little faith. It's on your end. Lord, why did I begin to sink? Now, why did he begin to sink? He saw the storm. If he hadn't seen the storm, he would have done all right. That's what that infers. Why does his mind think that way? Why does his mind think that way? When he sees the storm, he believes he can't walk on the water. He's a fisherman, and in the boat, a storm is trouble, and he's trained that way. He's been conditioned by life and the experience of the natural realm. All his life, he's been conditioned by the natural, and people have been conditioned. They've been conditioned by the natural. They've gone to school and they've been indoctrinated. Well, some of that is good. But when the natural overrides the supernatural, you're not going to enjoy the supernatural. We need to be transformed by the renewing of our mind with the word of God. The natural is good in the natural place, but the supernatural is to overcome it and override it. And I'm transformed when I get a hold of the word of God. And so people are indoctrinated. They've been taught this and that, and they've been conditioned this way or that way. Peter was a fisherman. He knew boats, and he knew storms meant trouble. And now there's a storm, and that means trouble when you're out on the water. His mind was conditioned that way. So when he saw the storm and the wind boisterous, he began to sink because he was afraid. He was afraid because he saw the storm. He saw the wind boisterous, and he was afraid because he was conditioned that way. He was trained that way. You've got to get retrained. You've got to get reconditioned. You've got to be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that the storm doesn't change the word of God. that it used to change things, because in the natural, storms mean trouble. When you're on a boat and you're in a storm, you can be in trouble and the water can get into the boat and you sink, and this is trouble. He's been conditioned, but he's got to get reconditioned. The Word of God has now retrained me, and I've been transformed by the renewing of my mind. I'd want to ask him, you know, you see the wind boisterous and you're afraid. You've been trained that way. And I understand that when you're in a boat, you're in a storm, you understand some things. But Peter, hey, Peter, you're not in a boat. You're not in a boat. So none of your training makes any difference right now. You weren't even trained for this. So you're not in a boat. The storm makes no difference. You're not going to walk on the water on a calm day. If it was a calm day, your mind wouldn't bother you on a calm day because of your conditioning. But look, you're not in a boat. Now, how does that go in line with your conditioning? Your training. You weren't trained to walk on the water on a calm day. And so you're not in a boat. Peter, all of this is irrelevant. All of this is absolutely just absurd. You're not in a boat. So let's just cancel out all of your training. Let's just negate and throw it all away. Push all your training aside. You need to get retrained. You're not in a boat. You're on the water. And the calm day, it doesn't make it any easier. Now, get your eyes back on Jesus, because he's in the storm. He's walking on the water. Sometimes I've been there. They want the storm to cease before they believe God. Jesus didn't make the storm cease. I think one reason you don't rebuke every storm, because sometimes people are watching how you live in the storm, and you can be the right testimony and the right example. Well, we're just going to rebuke the storm. I want to see you live on top in the midst of the storm. You don't rebuke every storm. I mean, when the Spirit of God is upon you, the Word of God is dwelling up within you, especially if you have the gift of faith. But Jesus, in Mark 4, he rebuked that storm. But in Matthew 14, he did not rebuke that storm. And he isn't afraid of it. He's walking on the water in the midst of it. It's not changing anything about his lifestyle. It's not changing him. He's in the storm and he's not changing one bit. He's doing what he wants to do. He's living the way he needs to live. He's obeying God. He's doing what he would do if it was a calm day. The storm makes no difference to Jesus. He's just having a big time walking on the water. It's Peter that was the problem. Well, he didn't have enough faith. He had enough faith to walk on the water, but then the doubt robbed him. Why did you doubt? So Jesus wanted to talk to him about that. Here's what happened to you, Peter. You doubted. You looked at the wind. You saw the waves, the wind, boisterous. Don't do that. Keep your eyes on the Word of God, the promise of God. Keep your eyes on me. Walk in the Spirit. You won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. Just live by faith. We're to walk by faith, not by sight. We're to walk by faith, not by sight. We're to walk according to the Word of God and not what the circumstances say. And when the circumstances present themselves to me, I'm going to acknowledge the Lord, and he's going to direct my path. He's going to lead me as I acknowledge him. Well, Lord, you see this same as I do. But here's what your word says. Now, if he nudges me, like in the book of Acts, when they were going to go a certain way, the Spirit of God didn't allow them to go. They wanted to go to Asia, but the Holy Ghost suffered them not. They wanted to go into Bithynia and Mysia, and they were restrained by the Holy Ghost to go there. It's not time for you, not you, not yet. Be led of the Spirit. Jesus in John 7 wouldn't walk in Jewry because the Jews sought to kill him. Be led by the Spirit of God. In John 11, he said, I'm going to go wake up Lazarus. And they said, well, the Jews sought to kill you, and now you're going to go back. He said, if you'll walk in the light, then you'll not stumble, because you're walking in the light, not the darkness. He's talking metaphorically about walking in the Spirit. Walk according to the Spirit of God, the Word of God, and the Spirit of God. I'm acknowledging the Lord in the midst of this situation, circumstance, and the storm, and he's directing my path. And according to the Word and by the Spirit, I'm going to have a big time, even in the midst of the storm. I'm going to walk on the water in the name of Jesus. Can somebody say amen? Amen.